We have Team Bazaar versus TNC. I'm Lysander, joined here by Terrence. You know, I've never really casted a few before, man, but I'm looking forward to it. Yeah. But yeah, these two teams, you know, you're probably more familiar with them, you know, you a C enthusiast. You know, I have spread my attention across in the regions as of late, but you know, I'll be relying on some of your knowledge for to get through this cast. We've seen a little bit of Bazaar, you know, we actually watched a lot of them today. But TNC, I've heard nothing but good things about them recently. I mean, after they lost Jimmy, they, you know, people say, oh, okay, maybe they lost their Western influence, but I think they learned quite a few tricks.
Well, For me, TNC, they did really well during WESG. Then after that, they were like, you know, they were stomping. And they were like wild cards, you know. Everyone wasn't expecting them to perform. Mm-hmm. You know, previously, Raven was for Fnatic. They sort of didn't do too well with Fnatic. And after that, they sort of went back to TNC and was very surprising, you know. Maybe they learned a lot of stuff from Fnatic, you know, from Mushi. Mm-hmm. Then they just showed their results, you know, during the WESG. But after that, it's just like, no news. No, we haven't heard a lot of news about TNC. People have been saying that, hey, TNC doesn't not doing so well. But in this regards, Bazaar versus TNC is going to be an interesting lineup here.
Yeah, it's definitely. I think it's one of the. I looked at my schedule today and I said, okay, this is one of those that people might have, you know, might have gone under some radars. But I think this is a team that definitely have to look out for. You mentioned them being the dark horses. They were the dark horses taking out OG.
Yeah, that was
last
really
CI.
Surprising as well.
That is definitely something that should be noted. And
well, what do you think of this IO pick? Like right now, like we've seen NA Euro. Teams, some of them prioritize the IO. I believe it was Liquid. They love playing the IO pick once in a while. They show like they just very comfortable with it. But in C, I haven't seen a lot of really good IO plays. What do you think of this IO plays for TNC?
I think okay, the IO has two things that it could possibly be used for here. The last pick, they do have a slot for a mid laner, so it could be something for that mid lane they're looking to pick up. So maybe a Chaos Knight or a Tiny. That could be coming out here for the last pick or TNC, but it also could be used for the lone druid. There are a lot of functions you could use with it. You can teleport him to safety.
I don't think I don't think that lone druid requires IO's assistance, considering that there is this
more of like
role.
A save.
Yeah,
like,
it's, yes, it's precaution.
You know? Use it for the save. You use it with a centaur for maybe ganking. I mean, some teams can be really creative with IO, but I think you're right. It's more likely that they're going to be last picking the IO's
right.
partner.
Yeah, so it's IO, like you're mentioning IO Tiny. It could be an IO OD as well. Like it's just, it's really hard.
IO OD, yeah.
I'm starting to like Team Bazaar's draft right now. OD's been banned off.
Okay.
I'm starting to like Team Bazaar's draft here. Like you see the synergy with Ogre Magi's Bloodlust, and also there's Empower to actually boost up Shadow Fiend. Mm-hmm. And not to mention Presence of Dark Lord. So this SF is like, you know, a synergize around SF,
but there's no melee hero to make use of his empower. So I'm thinking a Juggernaut is probably going to come out here.
You know,
Juggernaut,
Core Magnus is good. You know,
Core Magnus. No. I think it's more off lane Magnus. They're going to probably pick PA.
You know, in some situations, though, they actually go for Echo Saber, Shadow Blade. It just destroys everyone. People
wouldn't
expect
the mid Magnuses do that. But they don't actually take the position one most of the time. I don't know. Bazaar could have a.
It's pocket force to be reckoned with.
It's powerful, but it's no PA with Empower.
I don't think Bazaar is more of pocket strength though. Like previously,
they just need to play well, and then I think it's going to be that Nana is going to take a lot of attention with his Shadow Fiend, and then we'll have the Ajit and Afu just low key owning the game. Well, we'll see what happens here. I do believe it still will be Jug.
What do you think about
Jug? Jug is best with Ogre.
True.
It's very standard, like. Okay, it's gonna be Anti-Mage. Alright,
honestly speaking, I'm not a big fan of the current Anti-Mage, like this current patch. Like, previously Anti-Mage is for the type where you keep on farm the other side of the map. Mm-hmm. And right now, this patch, there's shrines, it's much more balanced out. It's a little bit easier for people to actually rotate and defend against Anti-Mage. So I'm not really a big fan of it. What are your thoughts?
I like Anti-Mage. I think he...
Yeah, you're a Black supporter, aren't you?
No. I just like playing the hero. It's cool. But I think the reason why they pick Anti-Mage is because they want to have a hero that can make use of Magnus's Empower. At the same time, being able to jump the Lone Druid. I think the most important thing about fighting a Lone Druid is to be able to jump him.
True.
Because he's that quote-unquote sniper, and we need that Anti-Mage
but
get on top of him,
Manta,
and just wipe him out.
It's vice versa as well. Like, the Lone Druid, you root on the Anti-Mage, he's just stuck there. You can't exactly blink away either. I wouldn't say it's like a pure counter, more
but usually when you have blink, you have the first initiative, so... True. I think that's why they pick it for, because there's no real magic user here, and... TNC don't really have good catch as well, so Anti-Mage will be able to rat a lot around the lanes. There's Shadow Fiend as well to push out lanes. There's a lot of firepower that'll be coming out from Team Bazaar.
Yeah, not to mention having Magnus on board, you don't necessarily need to rush that Battle Fury.
Yeah, you could go Manta style right away with Vanguard. Some I've heard Maelstrom is a thing for some Anti-Mages. It could happen.
Would you agree to me if let's say Bazaar were to play a little bit greedy, instead of supports ganking and stuff like that, we have, let's say, Disruptor stacking camps early on, and then Magnus just somehow just rotates up top, well, gives a casual empower, allows the Anti-Mages to clear off stacks really, really quickly and get a fast Manta, a fast Bash or anything.
Yeah, it's very possible. I think that's the normal progression of a Magnus melee carry lineup. I'm more excited to see what TNC will pick here. I think a Tiny is looking pretty good.
Odie's been banned though. That's a bit sad.
Odie's been banned, but I think Tiny or CK is actually not
CK
bad.
Is good.
Yeah. I would really like to see a Chaos Knight.
Chaos Knight is a very, very underrated hero. People really underestimate
him. Long stun.
Yeah, long stun.
If you put a Chaos Knight and the IO together, it means that Shadow Fiend will probably need Ogre support.
Yeah, exactly.
Leave
like
your
the long stun, the slow, and you actually pull people out of position as well.
Yeah. 5 seconds left, we'll find out if it's going to be any of that. Or they could just go for Storm Spirit and make us look like fools. But no, it's going to be Morphling.
No, and I actually like the Morphling bit.
Alright. Cloning Anti-Mage is pretty good. I think apart from that, I think actually Morphling is weak against Anti-Mage, which is why I don't understand why they would vote for a Morphling.
The thing about Io is that Io needs to pair up with someone that hits really hard, like you said, Io Tiny, Io Odie. Odie hits really hard with the Arcane Intellect, correct? But in this case, Morphling just shifts all his stats into AGI, which gives him the additional physical damage, sort of like a Throw Ranger type of thing, and Io just boosts up his attack speed. He just hits really, really hard early on, like the first 5 minutes of the game, 6 minutes of the game.
Don't know. I'm not convinced. Anti-Mage is a known counter to Morphling because you burn all his mana.
But that's Anti-Mage is like early phase on the game.
But Morphling is no early game hero, so I'm not convinced with this Morphling. I think if anything, it will be a comfort pick of all things. Cuckoo just probably wants to play the Morphling. Very comfortable with the hero.
Yeah, we've seen TNC play a lot of Morphling, right? Yeah. Like, they're very, very comfortable with their hero as well.
Yeah, if they're comfortable picking it, sometimes might overrule the fact that you're getting countered by their Anti-Mage. But we'll see how it goes. I mean, ultimately, it's going to be who gets the laning phase done better.
Oh, X-Nova.
Yeah, X-Nova gonna get his warding adventure scouted out, but he shouldn't die here. There's Boots on Centaur, and according to ADTR, he tells me when you pick up Boots on Centaur, it means you're looking to pull the creep wave into your tower, so like cut off the creep wave from there.
Because it just gives you so much mobility. Like, people wouldn't expect, like, hey, Centaur Warner, oh, there's a Boots. They try to gank him. They can't exactly gank him because he has such high mobility. So it's understandable.
We'll look at the TNT side and let's see how things are going for them. We have Tims on the IO, we have Ryor on the Rubick, we have Morphling played by Cuckoo, and we have Sam H on that Centaur Warrunner. Last but not least, we have Raven going to be playing his Lone Druid. You did mention that Raven was one of the star players that returned to the team recently, and as a result, is one of the factors for their
speaking
success.
Of Lone Druid, what do you think of Lone Druid in general? Like, I know it's like it was one of the most favorable pick previously because of the attack range. But what are your thoughts about nerfing the attack range, nerfing the attack damage, and also some of the stats for Dragonite?
I think he was nerfed a little bit. I honestly don't think he's broken. He's annoying. He's not broken. I told you, like, there are many versions. There are many methods to fighting him. I've seen a lot of teams actually fight him with jumpers. Like, I like to call them jumpers. Heroes with high mobility, able to jump on top of their targets.
Okay.
So, like, Juggernaut with Blink Dagger. We have Anti-Mage that has a natural built-in Blink.
Oh, look
so
at no lane. Like, Morphling takes so much damage from this Ogre Magi. Just casually clubbing him in the face.
Yeah, it's just Ogre things at the start. And without the waveform and everything to deal with this, he will not be able to do well in this lane. I mean, alone against Shadow Fiend with the IO, he's okay, but with Ogre just going ham on him, it's not an easy lane to fight. And once SF gets his souls in, it's easy. It's easier for him to stay in
lane. Morphling is having a really, really rough time in the lane. But, of course, there's IO, you know, to keep him healthy at all times. Might as well, for now.
And Sam H doesn't really have to worry about dying here. He doesn't have a Stout Shield, so he has that move speed, like you mentioned.
Yeah. It's not going to be easy to gank him, but at the same time, having a Disruptor, you know, like, we've sometimes, occasionally, like people pick the disruptor try and counter Stardust off lane because Stardust is like so fragile, so mobile with the sprint. You just like you zip him back in, you know, catch him out of position.
Yeah, it's a similar thing with the Darkseer as well. But Sansar is a little beefier, a little harder to bring down, and he can actually just run up to Nova like that and just hit him with a double edge.
True.
And Anti-Mage isn't exactly the best hero to capitalize on a glimpse. No, it's not like a gyrocopter where
he doesn't
isolate
hit his heart,
him.
Right?
Yeah, you can't do a lot of solo damage. Meanwhile, you know, we talk about the top lane. Raven is not gonna have that good of an advantage versus Ben either. Shockwave spam is a real thing, and you're not gonna be able to. Well, as I say, that he gets a deny, but Raven's gonna have a
trouble here, though.
Easy, yeah. Okay, now Samage is dead. I think there is no glimpse though. The IO comes in, and there is the bottle charge, and that should be that.
Yeah, he's fine.
And they're gonna shrine together, and yeah, it's gonna be okay. Meanwhile, Morphling and SF gonna be left in the middle lane. Both of them pretty much on par in terms of CS.
That IO was so on point. Like he came in, and just saved his life, and he's now his full HP again. He's just gonna be soaking the lane a little bit up top, so he's gonna be fine for now, though.
Legit. Holding on to that skill point level 3, not knowing if he should pick up that double edge or not, and immediately regrets it as he gets hit by that nuke from the centaur. Spell shield. We've taken off some of that. Magnus, still feeling pretty bold. Face up against the lone druid.
He doesn't have skewer. No, I'm not too sure if TNC actually knows this.
They probably don't, that's why they're not going for the pull. But I think, honestly, Ryo should have just gone for the lift anyway. He's at full mana, there is no real cost to not using it. It's just wasting a lot of opportunity cost, you know. At the worst, you know, you just force out Magnus' skewer. And is there a waveform?
Nah, he should die. He used the waveform already, so he doesn't actually have damage to try and do much of that. But instead,
long raise. So, yeah, overall, it seems like Lone Druid is going to be able to get the top CS for now. Anti-Mage matching him in terms of farm as well. 22 to 20, and looks like it will be a... Might be a Vanguard. It might be a Vanguard because it's not a poor man shield coming out here from Ajit, and that might signal that he is going for Vanguard. But
well,
I could be wrong.
I actually like the Vanguard. No, it allows you to be sustained. Oh, no lane though.
Yeah,
Ayo here is dropping very, very low. Dry Afu might be in some trouble. Here comes the waveform here and double kill. Oh, is it going to be two kills here going to mid lane? Not a double kill, well.
Yeah.
Cuckoo here just
overestimating. He buys up a raindrop now. I think it shouldn't happen again. I think more of an overextension than anything. Oh, triple race! Oh man, Nana comes back, slapping him.
No, I was about to mention that Cuckoo is like, considering like starting, he wasn't feeling very comfortable having the ogre and constantly harassing him. And then he's like, I got two kills. It's not going to be fine. But Nana just returns the favor and just like triple race. Wow, amazing.
Yeah, the Morphling a little bit overconfident with that 500 health morph. So, triple ray is more than enough to take him out, and now Tims has to be careful as well. Don't want to get hit by that mid raise or the short raise, because the long raise is always the finisher.
At the same time though, Cuckoo does pick up a raindrop as well. So, they're looking to counter off some of the magical damage output. So, it's pretty good though. Yeah. Like a lot of teams actually underestimate this item. The mana regen early on for just 200 goes, there's just so much value in this item.
I don't think any teams underestimate this item.
No, I've seen some teams that don't even care about that ice item.
It's pretty insane. They should be caring.
Oh,
sure.
Ben here down bottom lane. He might be some trouble. He gets lifted up. Yeah. And
he's out of skewer, but he's got a shrine, so he's okay. He's just baiting him into a bad fight. But
The RNG on the bear was just not too good. Right now.
Meanwhile, Samage looking to sap some EXP from this stack that Nana's gonna be farming up.
This is very good for Samage, though.
Yeah, pretty decent. It's gonna be able to get that level 6 soon enough and have that Stampede available for ganks.
We haven't talked too much about the levels. Like, right now, Centaur Orn is level 4. Same with Ben. You know, both of the offlaners are doing pretty well, you know, considering that both are having not really a good time, I guess.
Mm-hmm. Afu. Only level 2 actually, if you even talk about levels. Normally he's the guy that's been space making and doing a lot of work around the map, but this game is
level
sparse.
Like usually Afu is the one.
Lone Druid bottom lane gets a solo kill on the Magnus. Did he try for any skewer shenanigans? He did actually. He tried to pull Raven into the...
But he was rooted though.
Yeah, he tried to pull Raven into that tower range. And
this hero is the definition of RNG. You know, it's same like Ogre.
I would say PA. Yeah,
BAs.
They're going for Nana. There's the lift forward. There's the slow, the skewer as well. They lock him down, the fade ball. No chance for reaction at all. Raindrop or not, that Shadow Fiend went down easy. TNC bring the score up 4-1.
I really like how TNC now, they're actually punishing this, considering that, like, they know that Bazaar right now, early phase, they can't do a lot of things. Like, Ogre Magi, yes, you can TP rotate and just cause one stun, but you have a Disruptor, which practically needs to have
the Courier! Now,
one more hit.
Him in. Might be in some trouble right here, though.
Yeah, no mind about that. Yep, he's going down.
Yep.
Yeah. Raven.
He's a lost child in the Lost Woods.
The Courier. 35 HP, double damage, not enough to knock down a Courier at this stage of the game. And again, they're going for that Shadow Fiend. So easy to punish this hero. Even have that Replicate in the back lines just for security. We have 3 seconds to the next waveform. Should be easy enough for Cuckoo to get it. Oh, it's getting body blocked by the Ogre. Will not get the kill. And now Tim's. Forced back off there, dodging that long race. One more tick would take him out, but Ah Fu blocks his carry. Blocks the enemy from his carry and keeps him alive. And the glimpse comes back. There is the race holding it, Nana. Pulls out the long rays and turns the tables on the Morphling.
Wow, that's just pure calculated there. Like, I wouldn't say it's luck, but Nana just literally calculated. He actually bottled himself before taking the last hit. It caused him like just one more hit to die. And the communication there with X Nova. You know, I would say the timing of the glimpse was just on point and just turned the fight for them. Just amazing.
Huh? Alright, Ogre is still level 2. Level 2 Ogre did so much for that fight, I think. That was all Ogre, honestly.
Yeah, and the Bloodlust at the last minute saved him as well. Like, he
body block prevents the waveform from coming out at the last second, exactly. Allowing him to bottle up, allow the raindrop to come off cooldown. A lot of things played a big factor into it.
But these are the minor things that just tells you the difference between a pro, you know, like a top level team with fairly average team, you know what I mean? It's very, very important. It's just amazing to watch these type of team games.
Alright, so Mr. Bear, level 8 now. Two more levels to the range, and that is when things get a little absurd. Cuckoo, meanwhile, I think it's good that he's doing well in this early game, because like I mentioned, Anti-Mage late game really counters up Morphling because of the mana burn.
True.
And he really needs all the advantage he can get. Yeah. I mean, yeah, Replicate is strong against AM himself, but ultimately, it is still a nasty thing to deal with AM's Abyssal Manta combo as a Morphling, because
would you consider Terror Blade a counter to Anti-Mage? You know, in the sense that you cast your first skill, you know, just to minus off some of his own
mana. It's annoying, but I don't think it's that effective in the long run.
Like mid lane Terror Blade could be viable. No?
Shadow Demon's way better if you're doing that for the illusion. Right?
Definitely.
I mean, it's a cool little gimmick, but Afu being level 3 at this time in the game is definitely not beneficial. Gets taken out by the burst combo once again, disrespecting the burst damage of the Wisp.
Punishing Afu just like that, considering that he's just so under level right now. You know, poor Ogre. He's so tanky, but just dying off like that, though. Yeah. A bit sad.
Oh, Ajit. He's got level 8.5 now. That Perseverance, so it's not going to be a Vanguard. I'm a little bit disappointed. We don't see any tanky mage this game. We'll see the good old Battle Fury.
What are your thoughts about this pickup by Ben? Like, he's aiming to go for the Helm of Dominator. Helm of Dominator, I know which most teams pick it up because of stats and an additional unit, but for an offlaner Magnus, would it consider like prioritizing the Wing Dagger?
Oh, getting chased again. Now they gotta pop the Shrine. The guy reaches there right in time to get the Shrine there. Again, Afu takes a fall there. Cuckoo, meanwhile, as the strength morphed it up, he's not gonna die there. Oh no, it ticks to the Tims! Was that Urn? Yeah, it ticks to the Urn. That was unfortunate because he was about to survive, but he aggroed the entire Ancient stack. And he ticked down to
the... I sort of understood why Nana wanted to pop the Requiem. Like, the moment he popped the Requiem, it was like, hey, TNC just back to hell. Why did I just pop the Requiem? But, like, being standing there for two seconds... Wow. Standing there for 2 seconds, the creeps just killed him off. You know? Him low enough for the urn charge.
What were we talking about? Oh yeah, Ben's Helm of the Dominator.
Yeah, Helm of
right?
Dominator, yeah.
It's definitely good for Magnus Gate. I mean, if you look now, he has 4 points in Empower. He's really just chunking points into this ability, and now hold up. There he goes, tries to go for the skewer away, gets munched on with that fear as well. Ben is gonna be taken out once again. Raven on the slay with that mega kill now. And the reason why he gets the Helm of the Dominator is one, it helps him stack up the creep wave, stack up camps that he will farm later on. You mentioned the Shadow Blade Echo Saber.
Oh yeah, this just helps him build 4 points into the Empower. Yeah.
He just builds up the Empower. The Shockwave is just for last hitting, you don't need it too high. And Shadow Fiend gonna walk right into the Baron, gets hit rude as well. They need that ability right now, but the TP's come in. And immediately, it's time to peace out. There's a skewer. The Rubick tried to get out of there, but unfortunately for him, gets himself caught up. Cuckoo joins the fun. He doesn't want to stop this. And now the RP, they might have overextended here. Still morphing the strength. Does he get out? No, he does not. Nana takes him out. The bear still munching on Ben. Ben needs one more hit to tick. And he does not die. So, the Blightstone, yeah.
That was such a disaster for TNC. Like they were diving so deep. Like, I was like expecting them to back off. Like, knowing that, you know, oh, we've breached to enemy grounds. You know, there's a shrine there. They can just pop it. It's going to be a hard fight. So, like, the moment they failed to kill off the SF, they just backed the hell off. And yeah, Nova just punished him by glimpsing back. I was like, huh, no. It's okay to just let the Rubick die. Why would you commit your Morphling and your Lone Druid as well, which is quite debatable, SK?
It's very greedy.
It's, you know, you're in enemy high grounds, and why would you just go there?
It's definitely the characteristic of C games. I mean, definitely these guys love to play aggressive, love to take high risk, high reward plays, and oftentimes punished for their missteps.
They're just punished just like that. I was like, hey, you know. They back the hell up, you know. I was actually trying to. I'm wondering what's going through their mind. Why do they think that they can actually take that fight? Like, is it because Morphling has a casual Regulant?
Which is greedy. Hype from how well the game has been going for them. Okay. But now the raw battle fury is being picked up by Ajit, so I expect his farm to skyrocket, especially with the empower boost up going, and with the bloodlust as well. He has the attack speed, but nope, he walks right into enemy territory, immediately gets feared up, and immediately brought down as well.
So that was a really quick battle fury, but considering that he was a little bit greedy, hoping that no one will find him in the woods and just get punished for it.
Yeah, it's very dangerous when you try and farm up the enemy jungle.
Yeah.
The blink there on Rubick, the stolen anti-mage blink, that's always good to have.
Oh, that's really, really important play right there. But top lane though, they're actually looking for Morphling. Nana.
Can they get him? I don't know. They have a glimpse.
They don't have a replica.
They have,
he's gone.
No, there is a, there's still that wisp keeping him alive with the urn charge. Nope, there's the raise. That's just enough burst damage to take him out. And Nana strikes him down. And like I said, this guy, he's gonna take all the attention to himself and then strike you down.
I actually like how TNC is playing right now. Like, the thing about Philippine Dota, I'm not sure if you noticed, Mineski does like this. Like, one of their members is being caught up in the other lane. They try and force a fight in the other lane. Like, just now while you were caught top lane, where Morphling and Ayok was caught, they actually straight away try to salvage the situation. They know that they're going to be gone, so they try to, like...
Anti-mage getting caught up. There's a jump forward, there's a lift. Yep, there's perfect chaining, and there's the Dragonlance. Lone Druid just strafing him down, and now Nova on the way out as well, but unable to run away as the bear goes ham, sickles him, and puts him in the ground, so...
Yeah, this is what I'm talking about, no? They like to salvage situations, you know? Instead of protecting the hero, they know they're gonna lose that hero. They just salvage the situation, get a kill in middle lane. At the same time, they know that they don't have ultimates, they just punish him like that. Which is quite nice, you know?
It's also a very early Blink Dagger on the Centaur that's really making the plays for them. 40-minute Blink Dagger, allowing the Lone Druid to just get that early pickoffs non-stop with the Centaurs that help, and now Nana going in there with the Shadow Blade. They don't know about this, but they will get the Aegis in time. Will they get it? Yes, they do, and the Shadow Fiend.
You know, I was expecting another, you know, like Bizarre Snatch.
Afu Snatch. Not Slaughter this game. He's an ogre that's been feeding.
He's a poor, sad, two-headed, dumb ogre right now.
He's been feeding. That's what.
Yeah. He's the bottom of the net worth, you know. Surprisingly, you don't see this too often from Afu.
Free bear! Yum!
Oh, 300 go. Easy.
I don't know, they get the Savage Roll as well. They're gonna keep the enemy at bay. There is no Aegis on him.
Free 300 go. That's just like one hero kill just there and there.
Yeah, more than one hero kill actually.
Oh no, bottom lane anti-mage gets caught up again.
Yep.
Ajit though.
They love this guy.
Yeah.
And anti-mage Battle Fury got it early, but you know, if you get it early and then you feed the next few kills away. Oh no, the Centaur once again just going ham. A single silence on him. Not sure the best silence usage there, but it prevents the Stampede from coming out. But Morphling looking to go ham here. The Glimpse is going to be there. Pulls back the Morphling, so the aggression stops. But Raven looking to lay down the law here. Afu running away, gets hit there. Constant strafing. What is distance, he says. And strafes him down from a million range away. Raven's got like, and TNC looking to push the issue here. They have that Aegis on Morphling, so.
I was expecting Ben to actually go for a really, really nice RP, but it's understandable why he didn't want to go for the risky play, considering that, you know, if you skew in the wrong place, you don't have a Blink Dagger, and you miss the RP, you're just screwed. So yeah, it's understandable
and,
why he didn't
and he
go
doesn't
for
have a, yeah, not having a Blink Dagger is a major part of why he didn't go in. I think the bigger mistake there, or rather the, I would say, no, maybe not mistake, but you could say it was more of a reflex thing, was to actually just silence the centaur alone when your main target would be the Morphling.
Yes.
Or true. You want to catch out that bear.
Yeah, they committed
as well.
Almost everything for just for centaur, right?
Yeah, the centaur, he's been playing a lot of what you could say YOLO plays, just jumping deep in there, absorbing all their hits, and then
baiting out spells as well.
Helping his team just have a clear way forward. And this Morphling not going for the E-Blade, actually, going straight into the Skadi, just wanting more stats. Wanting more beefiness against this heavy hitting lineup.
I really like TNC how like utilize the situation.
Oh,
that Tar though. Top lane. Yeah, it's gonna be fine. But yeah, as I was saying, like Ajit, he got a really, really early battle free, like 12 minutes in the game, and TNC sort of got that two really, really important kills on him, and he actually delayed, you know, right now 80 minutes in the game, he's barely got any farm, and it sort of feels like, oh, anime just got his battle free. He didn't actually capitalize of the 6 minutes that he lost because of dying two times, you know.
Yeah, he was trying to cheat out an early Battle Fury and just get away with it without threads because of their Bloodlust.
And that was good call power. TNC,
it was kind of cool, he could have cheesed, it could have worked, but he tried going the enemy's jungle and you can see like TNC actually plopped down observers.
Twice as well.
Yeah, they plop observers in their own jungle to prevent this kind of shenanigans, and you already see Anti-Mage again jumping into the enemy jungle, but there he is, the relocate, and Archie getting caught again, we just say it, and he gets caught. And he tries to blink, but
this is the third time
happening.
This is the third time Ajit gets punished for farming in the enemy jungle.
Value Observer Ward.
Yeah, value.
Oh, Nana is coming in there. Ooh, blinks away. I think he saw the Shadow Fiend. Yeah, he saw it because of that Sentry Ward. Saw that Shadow Fiend eke on in. And we're going to hug the tower for now. Nana throws out the Shadow Razors. He has that Arcane Rune in check, so it's going to have a low mana cost for his items. No Blink Dagger on the Magnus just yet, but Dragonlance on Shadowfiend means he just hit at the tower from here.
As for top lane, TNC is going to make for a trade.
Oh, they're going to jump in again. And again, they deploy the silence only on the centaur. They throw that Shadowfiend back into a more harmful position, but not going to not going to be able to kill him. But Tim's, probably going to go down here. There is a big kill to get here. Nana getting two plus the tower.
TNC was
base.
Ooh, top lane. TNC, very, very sneaky play there by Morphling. Yeah, like I think TNC was a little bit greedy once again. Like, they got a value tier 2 tower and they just forced the fight down bottom and just committed two heroes just then and there, which is quite, I would say, debatable, you know?
It wasn't terrible. Centaur is expendable, Io's expendable. They glimpsed the Morphling back, so he got to kill a tier 2. And pressure tier 3s.
No, they were actually trading towers. Then suddenly it's like, oh, they actually tried to force a fight down bottom, which is unfightable because the tier 1 was already gone and there were only 2 TPs on.
Mm-hmm.
So, because it's not like instant TP where 3 heroes can land on the spot, it takes turn one by one. So, it gives Bazaar a lot of time to pick off one by one at a time, which is quite interesting, you know, I'd say.
Yeah, Nana is really capitalizing on this. He's got 3,000 gold now and he's going to be able to build into that Silver Edge. Yeah, he really wants to pick up the Silver Edge, reduce that damage, remove the passives.
Well, what do you think? Which one is more important? The Rubik's passive, or is it Centaur's passive?
I think it's negligible at this point. It's more of the damage reduction that you want to land on one of the cores, like Lone Druid or Morphling.
Yeah, it stacks really well with the Requiem
damage
well.
By 40%.
Yeah, it stacks really well with the Requiem too.
It's kind of cool, the Requiem, yeah. But a double damage, that is definitely going to hurt in the next one. Time to pick a fight.
I smoked up as well, but Io, is it rebuked? No, it's not.
So they're just going the wrong way, and Morphling is going to benefit with a tier 2. Then they're going to get a tier 1 in return. There is a glyph here for the Radiant, so they can buy a little bit of time. Do they glyph? Do they remember the glyph? No, they don't. So Wasted not being able to glyph there, and they might glyph this to defend the bottom tower, but I think it will just be a tier 1 for tier 2. Which is actually
there's
value.
So much value for TNC right now.
Yeah.
So much value.
They're forced to TP, they can't trade tier 3s for this. SF still really wants to go ham on this. The anti-mage charging in as well. They are starting to take damage in this tier 3. They really gotta go. The glyph comes out and anti-mage stays behind. Try and get this one done. Disruptor is there to pull anyone back. So they have to be careful if they want to retreat. They have to retreat properly. And the Thunderstrike just get deployed.
Speaking of that though, Laundry does have a brand new BKB as well.
Okay.
So yeah, it's gonna be hard for him to kill him.
Yeah, it's gonna be good. They do get it. Oh, Stolen Centaur does stun up Tims. So it prevents him from actually TPing out. It's not too big a deal as they didn't capitalize on that, but they lost quite a bit of life on that tier 3, but they traded tier 2. So it's 2 towers for 1. Ultimately favoring Bazaar.
But at the same time, you know, we were speaking about this new latest patch or something. Like, I think first starting in the patch is 7.0, where we know that tier 2, you know, destroy all the tier 2s and you get a free shrine. So what are your thoughts about making it to tier 3 now? Is it better?
Yeah, of course, you want to get a tier 3 whenever possible. You get that extra shrine opening. And you already see that tower dropping low. If there wasn't a glyph there, it would have gone down. So the next push that comes in from TNC will probably take it down and open up the map there for the Filipino squad. I mean, we say this, but Bazaar aren't exactly out or anything. There is almost equivalent XP graphs and only a slight gold favor towards TNC.
True. But at the same time, though, TNC is pretty desperate. We can see another smoke attempt again by TNC. And they're like, okay, we tried to make an attempt. We couldn't go. We didn't get a kill. We got a tier 2. So let's try and get a hero this time. And both teams will actually smoke up.
They're going to try and snipe a hero and then try and get it in time for Roshan, because Roshan's about to respawn. Depends on the timer that comes out, the red line hasn't shown it just yet. They see the Shadow Fiend, the bear gonna be scouting out the smoke. And
they actually approaching.
Oh, they want to go for the bear. So they kill the bear, has no respawn, so they get another 300 gold. And the scan comes out from the Radiant. They don't want to approach the high ground there, but the Shadow Fiend kill, that is yummy, yummy, yum, yum. They take out that Shadow Fiend, and yes, he will not be able to get out of that one. And the Ogre as well, Afu. Gonna get caught out. Meanwhile, Roshan will respawn in about a minute or so. So they'll get this Ogre a nice little kill. Or they could pressure tier 3s and force out a buyback.
That was
from the Shadow Fiend.
Really,
I think that's gonna be the better option here. Forcing out buyback. 50 seconds on the sidelines. Almost guaranteed to have the buyback here if he wants to defend.
Yeah, they should actually force it, no? It's a really good kill on Nana. And Nana is like the most important role for Bazaar, because considering that right now Nana isn't doing so well. In the sense that he's not making enough space for an anti-mage, for Ajit. And Ajit
Not
is just
pushing.
Yeah, they're not wait, what? Why wouldn't you push? What are your thoughts? Why wouldn't you push?
I think the creep wave is just too far away. That's why.
Or is it because they're afraid of that?
The chicken pulled the creep wave too far. So it was backdoor protection and they couldn't take it. So
what are your thoughts? Or is it because they don't want to breach high ground because they know there is a Magnus with Blink Dagger and just a 5-man RP can be just devastating for them.
Yeah, but it's mostly because the creep wave wasn't there.
Okay.
You can't hit the tower without the creep wave, and pretty basic.
Fair enough.
And yeah, I mean, threatening buyback there would have been perfect, because they would have been able to challenge Roshan and challenge the game. Actually,
it would sort of balance out the economy for them as well.
They're slightly ahead in terms of net worth right now, so don't want to throw that lead away with some rash decisions. Like you mentioned, Blink Dagger, Magnus, 5-man RP is very scary. And,
but I understand, like, I kind of like what Bazaar is doing right now. Like, we know, like, Bazaar usually plays pretty aggressive at times. At this time, they're just turtling themselves, no? It's like, I understand, they actually fully understand what their draft can actually do about TNC. Like, they know there's a BKB on the Laundry. They're just casually staying in the base. They know, like, they don't want to force anything, they don't want to feed anything. They want just want to make sure and buy as much time as possible for RG to get his farm. And they just come back to the game. Oh.
Yeah, I mean, that's the plan. Whenever you fall behind, you have to play a little bit more careful. And allow your anti-mage to farm. I don't think he's too far behind. He's about that 12,000 mark. He's got the Manta, he's got the Battle Fury.
He's trying to catch up, no? But right now, anti-mage needs more that really, really huge net worth.
He just needs Abyssal Blade. Yeah, then he can really contribute to the fights. But yeah, we're gonna have that Roshan going over to the Morphling again. So another push that could be coming out. Oh, it's gonna be Lincoln Sphere for Morph over the Skadi for now. Blocks the Glimpse, I think that is perfect for him. Blocks Glimpse, blocks potential Mana Void as well. Very important skill.
No, I'm gonna suggest a really, really retarded item. What are your thoughts regarding Diffuser Blade on Anti-Mage just for the value AGI?
I don't see any use of it. Yeah. There's no ghost form to remove it, no buffs that you want to get.
It's just
rid of
a retarded insight anyways.
Okay. Well, I don't know what to say to that. But they get tier 3, so they unlocked shrines now. And Ajit just cut the creep wave like he should, you know what I mean? Like, this is the best move an anti-mage could do. Nana doing a little dance. That cuckoo taking half his life points as damage. And oh, now they're bouncing back. Nana pops that BKB. They immediately disengage. And Nana might regret his decision right now. They pull back the Morphling, but he has an Aegis. And they already committed to silence, so now he's going to feel pretty good about himself. Sam H is still tanking up quite a bit of that damage. There is that RP, lands on a bunch of illusions and one Morphling, and he goes right in there, slaps the Magnus over the head, and Raven is beyond godlike, by the way, guys. By the way, Morphling just going ham as he has that second life, really not fearing death at this point. YOLO doesn't apply when you're in Aegis.
No, right now, like, Brazai is having a tough time trying to do with this laundry, as also this Aegis on the Morphling. Like, they haven't done anything. Like, they haven't even forced the first BKB off the laundry. That just proves how far behind laundry is right now.
Well, going for the anti-mage, going for the Rubick, but he is feared up, but Nana strikes him down. The laundry probably want to back it out. The support crew is down, so best to just get out of there. Help. And they break the Lincolns, and they will bounce back Cuckoo. They might get him here. Aegis is down. Will he be able to escape is the question. 1 second left. They don't have a silence to chain this one up, but they have a chain stun and a lot of punishment as well. The Solar Crest allowing Nana to get that killing spree on the board. And I think that is the biggest swing they possibly could have asked for, this bug fight recap. Not showing me anything useful.
I think it's pretty equal in the sense where both are actually getting kills. So I wouldn't say it's bug, more like they equalized.
They didn't show the thing because the fight lasted too long, and they didn't show any of the useful stats. But hey,
but you start to show in the
definitely
right now,
a big win for Bazaar there, picking off the Morphling and his Aegis and a few other heroes as well. They got Centaur, they got the Rubick, but they got the Wisp.
I understand why TNC actually forced the fight. Like, they saw Ajit was down in the middle cutting creep wave, so they tried to force something and try to get a pick off, but instead, Ajit was really back, and they just get punished just like that.
Yeah, you also don't want to go too late against an AM Shadow Fiend. It's just not good for your Lone Druid. Lone Druid's powerful and all, he has that long range. It's good to exploit in the early phases of the game, but late game, Anti-Mage just jumps on top of your Lone Druid, and you're going to find yourself quite hard-pressed to have a response for that, so
I was expecting TNC to play objectives, but so far, they have been overextending their boundaries quite some time now. Like, after getting tier 3, you know, they tried to force an unfightable situation where they they were caught out of position a little bit, and it just, I don't know, what do you think?
I think Bazaar just respond too fast. Bazaar just respond too fast.
Yeah.
Too low level on those supports, and I think someone took a cooldown death timer res on time, I'm not sure, but they fought for so long that the enemy team respawn.
Yeah.
And now Ryo getting caught out there. That is a big one to get. A nice silence there onto the incoming Morphling. So he will not be able to get that stun on him and he will get poured out. So they do waste the silence. They get a nice Magnus kill. So that's a big team fight ulti out of the way. But do they go for tier 3s now? Raxus, maybe just pick up shrines, yeah.
I think they want to force the buyback on the Magnus, at least. You know, before actually venturing the shrines, knowing that the shrines is always going to be there anyway, so you can actually capitalize both if you want to. Like, you can see now, TNC could
20 seconds. They got to make it count. There's no silence as well. I think it's best
to
push in.
They have to.
Yeah, Cuckoo got the shrine though, so he decided to pocket that extra change, and here we go. The Rexes are going to go down. The Radiant Courier, on the other hand, takes a step down into the underworld. Apu getting stunned. Magnus out in 5. They really don't want to have to buy back on him, so they are not going to, but they will trade Rex. So they lose a set of melee Rex here, and TNC, now it's up to them to make a clean escape out of there. The waveform is not going to work. Oh, it does. It does work. He actually managed to waveform during the glimpse, which actually disjoints the thing. I think there's an invulnerability frame that allows you
to actually glimpsed onto the Laundry, right?
Did he?
Yeah, he glimpsed onto Laundry, and Laundry forced him with the BKB.
Yeah, so that made more sense. Yeah. Okay. And, 24 to 14, first rack, second. I think TNC can pat themselves on the back and say, alright, guys.
It's actually worth it. Like,
play some consistent.
Taking aside Rex, taking away Shrine, taking that just builds up a lot of the economy, and it's just like, nope, I'm good with it. I'm pretty happy with it.
Yeah,
it's finally looking for the objectives.
The BKB on Morphling is definitely a great pickup here. You want to pick that one up against, first of all, Silence. Second of all, you want to block the Anti-Mage Mana Burn.
Exactly.
And the incoming Mana Void as well. You, as a Morphling, just really cannot function without mana.
No, early in the drafts, though, I was a little bit skeptical on how TNC is playing, but considering that how they're playing so far, and I've been saying that, you know, they should have overextended a bit, but so far so good, you know, considering like they take six Rags. And what are your thoughts? Like, what's the plan right now for Bazaar?
I think Bazaar are still okay. If they lose another Rag, then they're in deep trouble. But right now they should just be doing what they're doing, split farm. There isn't a lot of potential to catch out this lineup. They play it safe. Bazaar can just, you know, get the anti-mage, blink the tree, just hide, do the typical rat thing, get the Abyssal Blade up. And once the Abyssal Blade is up, look to get a jump on the enemy heroes instead of them coming to you, capitalize on RP, and I think win the game from just map control, because yeah, TNC have the tools with IO and everything, but ultimately an anti-mage and a Shadow Fiend split farming is just gonna be too much for them to deal with.
I actually like this pickup from Bazaar, where Afu, instead of going for a traditional 4 star like, he actually got a solo crafts just for the anti-mage. You know, like, anti-mage is pretty squishy, and he just...
It also makes them squishier.
Yeah, true.
It's pretty common on Ogre Magi's as well, to pick up the solo crafts.
But still though, there's
it doesn't
no
really
four
need
staffs.
Items. It doesn't really need items, no. And...
We usually see Bazaar go for a very mobile itemizations, like 4 staff, solar crest, grimmer, you know, eels and stuff like that. But in this game, what are your thoughts? Why aren't they going for the items?
Yeah, solar crest is good. It makes people easier to kill, makes your guys harder to kill. And it helps you Roshan as well. I think that is one of the key factors.
Mm-hmm.
And it makes your ogre hard to kill as well.
I think the key item right now, like, should highlight is that X Nova does have a scepter.
He does
have a scepter.
Okay.
That's the MVP item for Disruptor.
If he catches them off guard, and there they are, looking to catch them off guard with that Smoke of Deceit, Morphling just jumps right in. This could be a perfect opportunity. That there is a relocate, so they have to be very careful when making weird plays like this. There's Tims to break the smoke, and oh man, do they see the Aghanims? They do not see the Aghanims, but they will jump onto onto the Wisp, who actually just jukes away. And meanwhile, the Centaur just jumps on the anti-mage. He's feared up. There's a stun as well. The Rubik lifts him up. There's the Aghanims. They drop the RP on a singular lone druid, but the AM is down. 79 seconds. I think this is a good time to buy back, sir. No, Ben, gonna run away as the lone druid PKBs and holds his ground, looking to slam into Nana, but Nana has that solo crest buff on him, plus the butterfly. Really dodgy fella here. Hard to get him. Rubik. Gonna bounce him back, and they do get the kill. That Raven, a beyond godlike streak on him. Both buybacks are available for both cores on the Dire, but it's looking pretty bleak here as TNC look to drop the hammer here. Bazaar, they need to pull all that buyback now and try and fend off borders. Otherwise, we could be seeing a GG here from TNC and what people might consider an upset. Oh, lift the on Rubik. This could be bust enough. Is it going to be enough? Yep, Anti-Mage forced to buy back. Perfectly timed
Savage Roar
is going to send him all running back to base. And
that was literally a savage spell. Savage. But yeah, like right now, Butterfly on the Shadow Fiend, like I think it was a little bit of misplay from Nana. Like he would have died there. He tried to man fight Morphling, but he actually popped the Flutter and just backed away. And there was no evasion. And Afu was forced to pop another Solar Crest, but it wasn't enough. But he tried to man fight anyway. But sadly to say, that didn't pay off. A little bit misplaced, but you never know. It's a messy fight, right?
Right now, they're just getting overpowered by farm. It's almost 10,000 net worth. The Sloan Druid is just... Well, let's look at that damage. And there's that Morphling. Gonna be buffed up by the Wisp. I think it was just a clunky initiation. Tims reviewed their smoke. They panicked. They tried to jump on the Wisp.
And Disruptor only catch a one-man Static Storm.
Yeah, again, the Static Storms have not been good. You talked about it being the MVP item, Aghanims, but you know, he's been silencing, like,
TNC has been
guys.
Taking
like,
the fight split.
Why silence Raven? Like, it doesn't make much sense.
True. Why silence Raven?
No, you silence Raven okay if you don't want him to use BKB, but you silence Raven and then you just leave him there.
Yeah, he was like one man. It was a Disruptor versus Morphling thing. So it was pretty weird.
He also has like the range.
Sorry, what's it called? Disruptor versus Cuckoo thing.
He also has a lot of range, so he can just stay outside. Like, okay, silence me, I'm just gonna shoot from the high ground, you're not gonna be able to touch me.
True.
And, it's getting pretty absurd here. Sam H doesn't have that Aghanim Scepter. Can you imagine when it's done? It's gonna be pretty stupid.
But speaking of this, though, we know that Bazaar has been buying a lot of time for anti-mage, you know? RG right now has an Abyssal Blade, has a Manta Style, and even with the Battle Fury and also the Empower, we haven't seen that impactful that usually anti-mage.
Messi keeps getting jumped and not jumping people. Exactly. This build is powerful when you jump someone, and you just Manta, Abyssal, and you just burn on their mana, drop them the Mana Void. You can really snipe someone, assassinate them real quick, but when you're getting jumped yourself, you just don't have that luxury.
Yeah, not to mention that there hasn't been a really good RP throughout this game.
Yeah.
Like there's been a one-man RP.
When your hero can shoot from so far away, you don't really have to stick together.
Yeah.
Raven can be on the high ground here, you have your morph thing somewhere in the middle, Centaur right in your face, so it gets a little bit hard to deal with this, and now they're gonna do the good old walk through your base with smoke.
Yeah, Morphling has Ethereal Bleed as well, it's gonna be the shotgun Morphling.
I like this using their Lone Druid.
There's just so much raw damage, just
gets
bro.
It. Yeah, he just gets it. Just enough. And now they're gonna show. They're like, okay. We're just gonna hide the rest of our guys. We're gonna show Lone Druid, who has that Aegis, by the way. The Mjolnir onto the bear. Get the lightning procs on him up.
There's just so much raw damage coming from TNC right now. The Lone Druid and the Morphling. There's so much right-click physical damage. Not to mention, they're pretty hard to kill as well.
Yeah,
like 9-second BKB.
Lone Druid is pretty hard to kill at this point. Like, anti-mage, I say it's good against a Lone Druid if you jump on top of him, but not when the Lone Druid's two big items on top of you plus Aegis.
Yeah, he does have a butterfly as well.
So you're not killing him that way. But they waste the bear again, so...
Yeah, the Solar Crest is just for the bear.
Two bears down.
Yeah. Two heroes. Two kills.
Yummy money, but is it gonna be enough? You don't really need the bear.
Yeah, he doesn't really need the bear at this stage.
Okay, they're gonna try and defend top lane, so...
Right now, the chorus from the side of TNC is just getting huge and huge, or by time. Like, BKBs is like, I understand, like, Bazaar is trying to bait out as much BKBs as possible, but TNC, they're just, you know, waiting for the right moment to pop in, and they don't exactly need to pop it so far. So the long duration could be one of the huge factors for TNC right now. What do you think?
I think TNC is pretty comfortable at this point. They need to use the Aegis to take another set of racks, and then after that, I think the game should be pretty comfortable.
It's gonna be a long 1 minute. Yeah.
1 minute, 45 seconds. They definitely want to use this Aegis for some kind of advantage. Shadow Fiend is waiting for an easy snipe here with that Silver Edge, and not sure about the wisdom of this move. There is that Rubick. He blinks away immediately, but gets two shots, dropping very low, and they skewer him. So
that was a 3-shot. You know,
he tanked it for the team.
Yeah, that was 3 hits. That's just how much damage Shadowfin is doing. But still, what's wrong right now? Like, what do you think? Like, Bazaar, I can see that they're trying really, really hard. You know, you can see a Solar Crest to buff up the evasions, or try to kill off the bears really, really quickly. But right now, like, I think
missing a stump.
Yeah, the golden opportunity here for Bazaar is the Wombo combo. Agree?
Yeah, Magnus, you land an RP on enough heroes, you could get him out. Oh, Morphling. That is a slight mistake. Has to E-Blade himself. This Nana Shadow Fiend is just not messing around at this point. It's got Empower, it's got bonus 300 damage. It's a lot of firepower.
400 damage, actually.
It's a lot of firepower to actually sit through. So they're going to do the smart thing and just peel away now. Wait for that Rubick to be back online. Maybe steal some key spells. Getting Bloodlust is good. Getting even Blink or Empower would be amazing.
Would you say that as time gold progresses, that Bazaar's draft is getting stronger by the second?
Yeah. I mentioned earlier on that they have to buy more time for themselves. Their late game is the better of the two, I say. Lone Druid does have that potential early, but you know, he's a long range attacker, and he'll suffer in the later game where when anti-mage gets the MKB to actually jump on him properly. Even now picks up the BKB, so less and less control options available here for TNC in the next few fights.
I actually like the BKB more. Like, BKB, you can just do so much more instead of just getting the MKB. Like, yeah, we know MKB is to counter butterfly, but MKB is bringing you damage. You know, it doesn't exactly bring you the survivability to tank through TNC's draft and burst, or even physical right click. So it's understandable why not to get MKB.
Yeah, he will get it later, I'm sure. The BKB is just for
For now, you know.
Survivability.
At least, yeah. At least
prevents,
get some hits.
Prevents any kind of chain stunning from happening.
So what are your thoughts about getting Eels on Centaur instead of rushing the Scepter?
I think the Eels is mostly for silence. Yeah, silence slows. It doesn't stop Glimpse, so there's that.
True.
But it's also good for Eelsing on some targets. Maybe if you wanna
stall sometime, like cancel maybe Requiem once in a while, but
cancel, cancel Requiem, you can also set up a nice stomp.
True.
With Eels. You can stop a skewer if you're really fast, you can stop an RP blinkin' initiation.
True.
There are a lot of uses. I think generally it's just for extra protection against the DOT of the...
And the movement speed, right? Like, force...
I think the movement speed.
Yeah, it's debatable.
Mana regen is also a possible solution, possible thing.
Mm-hmm. Yeah, the thing with Centaur is like, he's always lacking in terms of mana. Sometimes you go for the talent, talent builds are going for mana regen. Like, in this case, yeah, you can see Centaur going for the 2+2 mana regen. Actually.
Okay. Probably now gonna wait for the Aegis to respawn before making any kind of sudden moves. TNC don't want to throw their advantage away. Bazaar are starting to eat back into this game. The Anti-Mage already up at 2007. The farm will only grow exponentially.
What are your thoughts regarding Aegis pick up on the level 20 talent? Like, would you say that 50% evasion would be better than the plus 10 all stats?
I think he's just going for the bulk. MKB is going to come up now after Nana gets his butterfly countered, but that's a Rubick again,
Real.
Tanking the gank for the team. Tims, oh, they might pull Predator. I think they can pull Cuckoo back. The Glimpse. Nope, Disruptor a little bit too far away. So they get a Rubick. It's a 50 second.
Like I can see X Nova trying his very, very best to try and glimpse that, but
oh wow, what is this? Holy crap, that is.
Holy crap.
Cheeky, that's good actually. Pulled them all back and you only lose your Wisp. That's perfect actually. Okay, yeah, so they glimpse him.
No, we're looking at a.
That's a lot.
I would say Admiral Bulldog strat here.
It's, well, it's pretty good. I think that deserves a clap on the back.
Yeah,
for sure. That was a move that pulled all the heroes of Bazaar back and gave them time to respawn, retake the map, and then maybe secure that rush pit, because this guy is up in about 30 seconds. So this is a crucial time to get back map control.
Yeah, let's bring back to the question. No, I was asking about Anti-Mage, like 10 plus 10 all stats and 50% evasion. Would you say that the evasion would be better?
All right, let's put it in numbers, all right?
Okay.
10 to all stats is an ultimate op, 2,100.
Okay.
Talisman of Evasion. Okay, never mind. SF is dead. No, pumps the BKB in time, and then Magnus saves him with the RP, but oh, man, melting. That's Raven, that's like, all right, A-click, easy. A-click, and they all get shredded. But the Ogre gonna tank that one for the buddies. Ben, in trouble. There's your Eel Scepter, sets up a Disruptor. To be killed off, and they get another two big kills. RP committed as well. SF nearly getting bust down there. His Magnus saving his life, but in return they lose two supports. But yeah, let's do some math. 2001 on the stat, on the stats, and then 15% evasion. That's a talisman. So that's 1800. You can do that.
I wouldn't say that in terms of value, well, between these.
Yeah,
items,
and also like... because SF already got a butterfly, so the evasion
yeah,
is probably going to get countered.
Soul Crest as well. Yeah,
it's going to get countered by an MKB very shortly.
Okay,
so
fair enough.
It doesn't make much sense. You want to be more tanky. You saw how much burst that TNT have, and they now get the Aegis, and that comes with cheese as well, with the IO combination. That's a full heal on a hero. Scary stuff in Bazaar's future, I think. They might be dropping a game here if they're not careful. 30,000 net worth on the bear, so it's going to start putting stuff on his pet.
I really like this pickup by this talent tree pickup by Raven. Like, instead of going for the entangle duration, he just went 10 seconds Savage Roar. Just play with the Savage Roar, you know, bait them out, you know, just take objectives over objectives.
Oh, there's a silence there, getting the Morphling, but the Magnus immediately removed from commission. There you go, Archer deploys that BKB, but hello, Anti-Mage, Lone Druid Illusion shredding the Disruptor, as well as that Magnus, and the E-Blade as well, snipes him with the shotgun, and now Cuckoo going for that melee Rex. They are really running out of firepower here. There's the RP on one hero, the Centaur comes back with a return fire, and immediately Raven sends them all packing with a triple kill and a beyond godlike. still on Ravens. Lone Druid, Shadow Fiend trying desperately to stop this wave of agility heroes, but it's not gonna happen as they all buy back into the game, looking to turn this around. The Mana Void already blocked there by the Lincoln Sphere. Anti-Mage getting too many snowballs thrown to the face. Gonna have to run away. Disarm, stun, ghost up, trying to do his fancy dance. Shadow Fiend will pop the shrine, trying to keep him alive, but Cuckoo says no, puts him back into the floor, and that's gonna be GG with 120 seconds on the sidelines. TNC upset Bazaar, I would say. Yeah. I wouldn't even say it's an upset. I think TNC is a really good team.
We know they're they haven't been performing since after WESG, so we were like wondering like, huh, is TNC gonna be doing good? But this game just shows them like, you don't underestimate Pinoys.
Yeah. Definitely. Of all Pinoys, definitely TNC.
Dang.
One of those teams you don't want to mess with. And it's really cool. I thought that the Morphling would be picked to clone Anti-Mage, but Anti-Mage was such a lightweight this game that they decided to clone the Druid.
Yeah, the Druid. Like they couldn't decide whether which is the real Lone Druid